This morning, isn't it great to be in God's house this morning?
Yes.
On the count of three, let's do a great big hallelujah, okay? One, two, three.
Hallelujah.
There you go. Stand to your feet if you're able. Stand to your feet if you're able. Look in your praise course book. Your praise course book number 5. This world is not my home. We're going to kick it off this morning with that. This world is not my home.
This world is not my home, I'm only passing through. My treasures I lay up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
Sing it out.
Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, oh Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. They're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know. My Savior pardoned me, and now onward I go. I know He'll take me through, though I am weak and poor, and I can't feel at home in this world. If heaven's not my home, Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
Don't these instruments sound good this morning? Let's give them a round of applause. Okay, get ready. With that third verse, here we go. I have a loving mother.
I have a loving mother up in glory land. I don't expect to stop until I hold her hand. He's waiting for me now in heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know like you. If heaven's not my home, Lord, what would I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
Let's pray. Precious Heavenly Father, we lift you up and we exalt you on high. We ask you to keep us all close to you. Bless the service, bless PK as he presents it. Bless the musicians. And Lord, just bless other churches and let them all get right with you and make things really on fire. So we thank you and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Going to do a couple of announcements real quick. There's plenty of announcements in your bulletin, so be sure and look in your bulletin for announcements. But one thing we're needing is some volunteers. So we have several ways that you can volunteer if you are willing and able. We could use you on the sign-up sheets, which are out above the coffee maker in the fellowship hall, signing up for goodies. We don't have anybody signed up for goodies, really, for the rest of the year, so there's plenty of opportunity there if you're willing to sign up for Sunday morning goodies. And the church is more than willing to pay for those. If you'll just do the shopping and bring in the goodies, then bring in your receipt, and the church will be glad to reimburse you. So we have an area there which we could really use some volunteers. And we also have an area where we have another sign-up sheet out there, and we ask for people to sign up to help clean up after every Sunday morning service. It's not cleaning the whole church, don't worry. We're not going to try to get you out here, see if your hand fits the vacuum cleaner. Nothing like that. But it is picking up the trash, the papers, you know, cleaning out the back of the chairs, making sure the pockets are all ready and everything for the following week. So we have people that are doing that pretty much every week. But, you know, we want to open that up and see if we can get some other people to volunteer and help us out there. And then finally, if you look at the lighting all throughout the building, you'll find that some of the lighting is LED and some of the lighting is just the regular old-style bulbs. And we have some that's really white and some that's yellow. And we're trying to make our camera do a better job as it films the services. So our in-house professional, Rodney Brudevold, right back here. Wave your hand, Rodney, so they know who he is. Okay. Him and his expertise, we redid this back corner light back here. And this back corner light is all LED with the ballasts removed. And it's not a hard thing to do. It just takes time and then cleaning those these plastic things out so that we get a good reflection. And if we do the whole sanctuary like that, it'll brighten everything up just big time. I don't know if you can tell, but you know, the footprint on the floor in that. Those folks back there are really going to be able to read their hymnal in a minute. So we know we're going to get some good music from back there. But we're going to be doing that tomorrow morning about, what do you think, 8:30? 8:30? About 8:30 tomorrow morning. And Rodney will be up on the ladder, and if I'm available, I'll be here, and I'll be up on the ladder. But we could really use 4 or 5 volunteers, doesn't have to be men, anybody that can just hand us light bulbs and take the light bulbs down. And, you know, as we change these over to LED, LED costs about 10% in electricity, what the regular lighting costs. So it's going to save our church in electric bill, plus it'll be a lot brighter in here. So if you are willing to volunteer for any of those, we would appreciate it. If you're willing to volunteer for the lighting, if you'll see Rodney after the service and let him know that you can meet him here tomorrow morning at 8:30, we would appreciate that. If you're willing to volunteer for either of the other items, the sign-up sheet is over the coffee machine. So the other announcement that I had this morning was Wednesday night service. We will be having Wednesday night service this coming week. We will be having another prayer time and video. Sue Campanelli has a great video from Amir that we'll be sharing tonight, or this coming Wednesday night, right? Jesus in the Old Testament. It's going to be a great time. And we'll have, we'll have our prayer time, which is for the health of our church, health of our community, and the nature of a lot of things that are going on in this world around us. And we just want to pray. You know, the Bible says to, you know, start out on our knees. And also where two or more are gathered, you know, there he'll be in the midst of us. So we come together as a group. We usually have, you know, at least 12 or 15 people. And we start out on our knees praying and asking God to take care of us, take care of this church, take care of our community. And we bring some special needs, usually on just specifically on Wednesday night, just some private needs and things that people just need prayer about. Are there any other announcements?
I have one. May I?
Okay.
Yum, yum. Spaghetti feed, save the date, September 23rd. That's a Friday night. We have it in here. And it's all-you-can-eat spaghetti with a dessert auction. It's a lot of fun. There's more to come. It's $5 per person, $15 per family. This is bad English. This is the most funnest time this church has. So come for food, fellowship, and just a great, joyous time. See me for the tickets. I'm selling them. So there's another sign-up sheet right here. So please come see me. Thank you.
I think Linda's got an announcement that's still working on the quilt.
Yeah, but it's in the announcement.
Oh, it is? Okay.
Be sure to get your tickets to the quilt. And next week we will have a table set up where you can buy from
Okay, so if you're able to stand to your feet, we're going to sing a little bit more. We're going to have a little more fun.
Yeah, I just wanted to announce, too, that the Wednesday after this next one, I'll be starting a study in the book of 1 Corinthians, and we'll go through 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. Yeah, that'll be good. And then also, it's been requested that I teach of how to witness to people, okay? And so I will give you whatever wisdom that God's given me on that subject to you. And so it'll be fun because, you know, there's a lot of people that feel very uncomfortable about sharing their faith with people, and it really shouldn't be an uncomfortable thing. So I'm going to be doing that. And then next Sunday, Pastor PK has graciously allowed me to preach. So I'll be preaching next Sunday, okay? Anyway, we'll have some fun.
That's right. So let's continue to worship this morning and stand to your feet if you're able. One of my favorite songs in your Praise Course book number 58 is Keep on the Sunny Side. And we're going to play like we're just kicking things off again. Okay, so Keep on the Sunny Side, number 58.
Chapter 28, verse 1. That's Acts chapter 28, verse 1. And we read, "Once safely on shore, we found out that the island was called Malta. The islanders showed us unusual kindness. They built a fire and welcomed us all because it was raining and cold. Paul gathered a pile of brushwood, and as he put it on the fire, a viper, driven out by heat, fastened itself upon his hand. When the islanders saw the snake hanging from his hand, they said to each other, 'This man must be a murderer, for though he has escaped the sea, justice has not allowed him to live.' But Paul shook the snake off into the fire and suffered no ill effects." And Father, we thank you that you are here with us today to help us learn what all this means, what you'd have us believe and understand. And Lord, thank you for just being with us and loving us and helping us to love one another. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Not too long ago, I went out to the Medford Gospel Mission to play some country music and share God's word with about 25 homeless men. That night, 9 of them accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and I went home feeling really blessed. And on the way home, I started thinking about something Jesus had said to his disciples on his last trip up to Jerusalem, on his way to the cross. He said in Matthew 20:28, "The Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life as a ransom for many." The Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life as a ransom for many. He said this to his disciples so that they would go and do likewise. He says that to us this morning for exactly the same reasons. We have not been given the light of Christ to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give our lives as a ransom for many. You see, we're all ministers for Jesus. And in this sense, the Christian life is not so much about being good as it is about doing good. And 800 years ago, before the birth of Jesus, Isaiah the prophet wrote this. And I'll just read this to you. Isaiah 42:10. "Sing unto the Lord a new song. Let the wilderness and the cities lift up their voice. Let the inhabitants of the rock sing. Let them give glory unto the Lord, and let them declare his praise in the islands." Let them declare his praise in the islands. The islands refer to any place or any person that had not yet heard about the goodness and mercy of the living God. And Paul, in his calamitous voyage, reached just such an island, Malta, one that was ignorant of the glory and majesty of God. And folks, this is true all over. It's true in the city of Eagle Point. There are all these little islands that have never heard of God. All over the cities of Southern Oregon, there are little islands that haven't heard of God or know of Jesus. In fact, all over America, there are little islands walking around who don't know God. And unless someone reaches out to them, they're going to die without ever having seen the true light. God wants us to reach those islands. Now, Pastor Steve sort of talked about this a little bit up front, which I thought was neat. We are here to serve. We are here to give. We are here to do. We are not here just to be. And it's really, really interesting how this all works. So with this in mind, let's return to our story. Paul has been arrested in Jerusalem for preaching Jesus in the temple, which caused a riot to break out. He is now being deported to Rome to be tried for the civil disturbance because he informed his jailers that he was a Roman citizen, which he was, and demanded that he had a right to be heard before the Roman court. During the voyage from Jerusalem to Rome, the ship he was in hit a terrible storm and eventually collided with a sandbar and ran aground just off of Malta. Dr. Luke, who wrote the Gospel of Luke and also the book of Acts, is Paul's traveling companion, and he writes in Acts 27:41, "The bow stuck fast and would not move, and the stern was broken to pieces by the pounding surf." And he adds, "The soldiers planned to kill the prisoners and prevent any of them from swimming away and escaping, but the centurion wanted to spare Paul's life and kept them from carrying out their plan. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land. The rest were to get there on planks, on pieces of the ship. In this way, everyone reached the land safely." Everyone reached land safely. And this is where we came in. Once safely on shore, we found out that the island was called Malta. Now, the first key to effective ministry is key one, bloom where planted. Beyond question, Paul never expected to have a 3-month ministry on Malta. But there's an old saying, if you want to make God laugh, just tell him your plans. And this is painfully true. One thing I've learned in my 27 years of ministry is that God's plans are difficult to understand and decipher, which means just when you think you got them all figured out, you end up on Malta. In my church in Ashland, I had a good example of this. My wife Jeannie mentioned that there was a woman in the congregation that had a really good singing voice, and so I eventually asked her to join the worship team if she'd like to sing. Well, she kind of hemmed and hawed and didn't know what to say until I assured her that she only had to sing if and when she wanted to. The next thing I knew, she was on Malta. She was on Malta. God shipwrecked her onto the worship team, and her ministry began. And even now, her ministry is continuing at another church in Ashland, where she is using her spiritual gift of singing to prepare people's hearts for God's word. My story is similar. 30 years ago, I went up to the Green Springs just to help out a pastor friend of mine who had been sent there by Applegate. About 8 months into it, I called this pastor and told him I decided I was going to go back to Applegate. He said, "That's too bad, PK. We were just about to ask you to become the new pastor." I said, "I'll be right over." And that's how God shipwrecked me on Malta, on Green Springs Island. But really, it started earlier than that. When I felt the Lord calling me to the ministry, the first thing I did was ask the second in command at Applegate, "How do you get into the ministry?" And he said, "Just hang out with the folks after service and pray with them." In other words, bloom where planted. And within 18 months, I was pastoring a church. Now, those things seem hard to connect, but they're not. You put yourself in a position to help, and something God just helps you. My point, whatever you may be feeling God calling you to do, just start doing it. If you're getting one of those little pulls on you like I got, I was sitting out at Applegate on a Wednesday night listening to John Corson talk, and I said, "That's me. That's what I want to do. That's what I want to be." And I just started hanging out with people and praying for them. Pretty soon, God did all the rest. You see, God brought you to himself for a reason. Sometimes we lose track of that. Sometimes we start thinking of church as just something we do. But you're not here for unknown reasons. God has brought you to himself for a reason. It is not an accident that you are here in this church, and it is not an accident that you are here today listening to me. God used a storm, some high winds, and a raging sea just to deposit you on Baptist Creek Island, if you will. And just so you know, your ministry does not have to be complex or complicated. I love how Mother Teresa put it. She said, "Let no one ever come to you without coming away better and happier." Is that a great slogan? Don't let anybody go away not until they're better and happier. And that's ministry. Anyway, the first key to an effective ministry is key one, bloom where planted. Luke continues, verse 2. The islanders showed us unusual kindness. They built a fire and welcomed us all because it was raining and cold. Paul gathered a pile of wood, of brushwood. This brings us to key two, pitch in. Pitch in. I like this. The first thing Paul does is to contribute to the work at hand. He gathers wood for the fire. Now this may seem like a no-brainer, but I was very slow to learn this in my own ministry. I remember looking at the broken top step and the three steps leading up to my office door and wondering why none of my people ever took the time to fix it. After all, I was the pastor. They should have been serving me. But when I told my pastor about this, he said, maybe the first step in your ministry is to fix that first step in your ministry yourself. What, I said? No, I didn't. I can't tell you how offended I was, but that's exactly what I did. Did anything change? Not with them, but it did with me. When I planted my last church, Joy Chapel of Ashland, I arrived there willing to do anything that came up. But guess what? Without ever being asked, everyone just pitched in like there was no tomorrow. Frankly, I'd never seen anything like it. I believe it all began because I was willing to do it all myself if need be. And God knew I had reached the point where I was ready to receive help. In your ministry, whatever it is, you need to pitch in too. There's always work to be done. There's always something you can add. There's always someone who needs a helping hand. There's always someone who needs a willing listener. There's always someone who needs a friendly smile. By the way, with regard to this church, I sometimes feel like I could have almost left this thing out about pitching in. I think this church pitches in as well as any church I've ever been to. You guys are great at it. However, I still like to remind us all that serving Jesus is not just about how good you are, it's about what good you do. And you'll see this all through the Bible. The doing is the secret, not thinking or wishing or feeling, doing. So for effective ministry, and we're all ministers, one, bloom where planted, don't wait, two, pitch in, and Luke adds, and as Paul put the wood over the fire, a viper driven out by the heat fastened himself to his hand. When the islanders saw the snake hanging from his hand, they said to each other, "This man must be a murderer, for though he escaped the sea, justice has not allowed him to live." But Paul shook the snake off into the fire and suffered no ill effects. Key three, shake it off. Shake it off. No matter what God has called you to do, you will be attacked. You will be attacked. Sooner or later, the old snake himself is going to bite into you, and it is absolutely unavoidable. But, and hear me, it is how we react to this that really matters. How we react to being bit. There's an old antiperspirant commercial that says, "Never let them see you sweat." Remember that? Never let them see you sweat. I agree with this. Although it's often nice to be transparent so people can relate to you, it's also important to remain in control of yourself. You see, self-control is the summation of the fruits of the Spirit. The very bottom of the pack holding everything up is self-control. So if I get snake bit, let's say Satan comes and or sends someone to insult me, and I defend myself by ranting and raving and acting like an idiot, I've just become a very poor witness for Jesus Christ. I have just become exactly what they were expecting I was, a great big phony holding a Bible. But if I just shake it off, if I just turn the other cheek, then the Christ in me is glorified. The Christ in me is glorified. Listen, we all are under attack. We all are going to get bit. But here's the good news. It is only how we react to adversity that people can truly see Christ in us. That's the only time they see him. So sometimes it helps to get bit once in a while so people can see how well you're doing through Jesus Christ. Anyone can be composed in the good time. Anyone can smile when things are rosy. Anyone can be upbeat and jovial when the sun's out. But it's when disaster strikes that our true colors show. It's when disaster strikes that our true colors show. Have you been insulted? Shake it off. Have you been snubbed? Shake it off. Have you been tempted? Shake it off. Have you been socked in the gut? Shake it off. Everyone is waiting. Everyone is watching. Everyone is tuned in just to see what you're going to do. To them, your reaction to adversity is the measure of your faith. Your reaction to adversity is the measure of your faith. Never forget, all the natives, all the islanders, all the lost souls, all the walking dead are watching you. So for effective ministry, bloom where planted, pitch in, shake it off. And Luke continues in verse 6. The people expected Paul to swell up or suddenly fall dead, but after waiting a long time and seeing nothing unusual happen, they changed their minds and said he was a god. Key number 4 is be humble. Be humble. When any ministry becomes very successful, there's always a danger that its followers are going to start worshiping at the wrong altar. There's also a danger that the minister will allow this. I've often said that I'm glad John Corson decided to work for good instead of evil, because he could have led a whole lot of people down the wrong road. One of the greatest tasks a pastor may face is to stop his congregation from elevating him. He's not Jesus. Jesus is Jesus. And we all should know this. We elevate Jesus, but we don't elevate each other necessarily, not for that same reason. I remember telling my pastor once that I was amazed how rarely anybody ever came up to me after one of my sermons and complimented on me on what a really great job I'd done. Still am, to a degree. John said, I know, that's a tough one. If they come up and say that my sermon was stunk, I have a problem. But if they come up and tell me that it was great, I also have a problem. I understand that. I know what he's talking about there. Having great fame in any ministry can erode the ministry, contaminate the minister, and poison the believers. But there's another reason for staying humble. Let me abbreviate this following text. Paul wrote this in Philippians 2:5. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself unto death. He humbled himself unto... Not too long ago, I was listening to a CD by Bob Dylan. A phrase from one of his songs really caught my attention. It was this one. When you've got nothing, you've got nothing to lose. I thought about that. That's interesting. When you got nothing, you got nothing to lose. It struck me as a profound little truth. Directly after that, I found myself struggling with a couple of phone calls I didn't want to make because I knew there was a lot of pain attached to them. And I realized the best place I could arrive, both as a pastor and as a person, is where I'm nothing. Where I'm nothing. Where I'm nothing. You see, the song says, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. That's all. That's all. That's not saving a little piece for something else. That's all. Give it all to Jesus. I am supposed to surrender all. And this understanding suddenly filled me with incredible peace. To paraphrase Bob Dylan, I suddenly realized, when I am nothing, I have nothing to lose. And I mean that, what's at stake? My good name? I don't have a good name. My pride? I don't have pride. My lofty position? I don't have a lofty position. You see, it can't bruise my ego if I don't have an ego to bruise. And I've said this too many times when I've stood up here and taught. Greatest thing I ever did was throw me away and start following Christ. And that's all I follow. I don't follow me at all. I don't listen to me anymore. I listen to him. That's why when I give it all, then I'm not afraid to have that talk. I'm not afraid to apologize to that person. I'm not afraid to correct that situation. I'm not afraid to be wrong, to be at fault, to be stupid looking, or any of these things, because nothing's about me. Everything is about Jesus. And just driving out here today to talk with you folks, we had a good long talk about how I was going to give anything he wanted to give to him, not to me. I'm not looking for me. Anyway, it's life changes. The precept works extremely well in marriages, in family disputes, with neighbors, with co-workers, and so forth. When we are nothing, we have nothing to lose. It's profoundly liberating. Fairly early in my ministry, I was invited to speak at a pastor's conference out at Lake Bradley. The leader of the event asked me to give a short talk to the other pastors about my ministry. When I was preparing my talk, I immediately thought of two things I wanted to share with them. The first was this. The first thing I thought of was a Far Side cartoon I had seen posted on the wall of a local coffee house. In the cartoon, there was this angry circus clown looking down at this long display of various handguns. He's wearing a pointed hat with a thing on the top, big fluffy thing, a collar with great big fluffy things on it, gigantic outfit with buttons all the way down, a pair of huge oversized shoes, and a large plastic red nose. And he's angrily thinking, laugh at me, will they? Don't you understand? He's dressed up to be laughed for. And he's all upset that people are laughing because that's called not understanding the nature of your job. No. Laugh at me, will they? Anyway, the other pastors and I stopped laughing. To them I said, guys, this is what you call not understanding the nature of your job. Then I went on to share another incident that happened to me when I was still new to the ministry. I was in my office after a church one Sunday when one of my parishioners came in with a frustrated look on his face. When I asked him how he could help me, he said, my wife and I don't feel loved by you. I almost laughed right out loud. I couldn't stand the guy. But that's... I didn't say that. I didn't like his wife either. But in just a fraction of a second, I realized his complaint was valid. His complaint was valid, and he and his wife had a right to expect their pastor to love them. And in the next instant, I decided I was not going to leave him left the room until he felt loved by me. Which meant, I decided to start focusing solely on Chubby Checker's famous refrain in the Limbo Rock, which goes, how low can you go? How low can you go? And I kept thinking, I'm going to go as low as I have to. The result, my wife and I became loving friends with both of them, and we still are. And that's understanding the nature of your job. It wasn't necessarily my feeling, but the nature of it was, you've got to love these people. And this is true with everybody. You may not love somebody, love them anyway. Ask God to help you, but love them. Don't leave it undone. Don't leave it undone. So effective ministry requires that we, one, bloom or plant it, two, we pitch in, three, we shake it off, four, we are humble, be humble, and verse 7 says, there was an estate nearby that belonged to Publius, the chief official of the island. He welcomed us to his home and for 3 days entertained us hospitably. And the fifth key is this one, be available. Be available. You see, one of the worst things that can happen to any minister is when the minister withdraws from the people who need him. When I was in Fort Lauderdale a few years back, and some of you know this about me, I'm also a children's author, was there speaking to some schools about my books. And because I'm also kind of a Calvary Chapel style pastor, I went to visit their Calvary Chapel church of 23,000 people. And the guy had only been open 4 years. And since I was also a Calvary Chapel pastor, I thought I'd introduce myself to their pastor. However, when I went in to see him, his secretary informed me that he was too busy to come out of his office. Too busy. I just finished 10 hours of school visits, 13 hours of flying, and 2,700 miles of traveling across the United States, and he's too busy to say hi. Well, let me ask you a question. Was he really too busy? Was he really too busy? Answer, that depends. Question, on what? Answer, on whatever he decides. On whatever he decides. See, I bet he wouldn't have been too busy to come out and meet the late Billy Graham. I'll bet he would have found time to come out of his office to say, oh, Mr. Graham. And that's the whole point. Being available is a disposition of the heart. Being available is a disposition. It's a choice. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't know this pastor. I never met him, and I don't want to judge him. In fact, I'm sure he's a great guy, but I just hope I'm never too busy to say hi to someone who's just come to my office from the other side of the continent. And here's where I'm going with this. Paul didn't have to go to Publius's house. Church tradition holds that Paul originally took a shelter in a nearby cave that is known today as St. Paul's Grotto. Paul could have said, look, Publius, I've just been through a shipwreck and a snake bite, and I think I'll skip the visit to your house and catch up on a few winks. But he didn't say that. He didn't do that. And here's what's happened. And hear me, please. People are what the ministry is all about. People are what the ministry is all about. Later in the ministry, I addressed another group of pastors at a conference held at the Green Springs. In short, I told them that one of the most important truths I had learned as a pastor is this. Basically, nobody remembers my great sermons, but everybody remembers how fast I got to the hospital when they needed me. And that's just the truth. Well, maybe you've missed some of my great sermons, but not all of it. It is important that mostly what you do as a pastor are the things you do for your staff, not things you say or how you bounce or whatever. It's what you do. And I'm very pleased to say that this is an important, very important thing. Stay available to people, speak to people, spend time with them, because people are what the ministry is about. And Luke says in verse 8, Publius's father was sick in bed, suffering from fever and dysentery. Paul went in to see him and after prayer placed his hands on him and healed him. When this had happened, the rest of the sick in the island came and were cured. Key number 6, use your gift. Use your gift. God has given you a gift. Use it. If you are a healer, heal. If you are a singer, sing. If you are a teacher, teach. If you are an evangelist, evangelize. Use your gift. Did you notice what happened in our story when Paul used his gift of healings? Nearly the whole island turned out to see him. Nearly the whole island turned out to see him. And this is exactly why God has given you a gift. He wants people to be drawn to you so that they will be drawn to him. He wants people to be drawn to you so they will be drawn to him. We are the only path he has. We are the only doorway he has to people. He uses us to reach out to people. And that's our job, to draw people to ourselves first so that they will be drawn to him. Use your gift. Now, you may be having trouble figuring out what your gift is. If this is you, just ask yourself, what do I like to do? What do I like to do? You see, after we receive Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, God does endow each of us with some supernatural gifts. Tongues, interpretation of tongues, prophecy, healings, to name a few. But he also harnesses the gifts we already have. Encouragement, discernment, administration, helps, teaching, preaching, praying, singing. The list is almost endless. There's an old saying that if you were a bad cook before you became a Christian, you're probably still a bad cook. And that's because God does not change your basic skills to suit his need. He harnesses your basic skills to fill his need. He doesn't change them. He harnesses them. He uses you for what you're already good at. And this is throughout the Bible you will see this. People who are working for the Lord, but they're doing what they were already doing extremely well. I was a good public speaker long before I ever accepted Jesus Christ. But now he's harnessed me for his use, and it's 10 times more satisfying. He's harnessed you to, and not to improve your weakness, but simply the strength you already had and the things you were already good at. Use those for his kingdom. Give your life to God. Let him use your gifts. And Luke concludes in verse 10, they honored us in many ways, and when we were ready to sail, they furnished us with the supplies we needed. After 3 months, we put out to sea in a ship that had wintered in the island. Finally, key 7, be Spirit-led. Be Spirit-led. Be Spirit-led. It is important to realize that most ministries are not for life. Generally, they are for a season. Remember when Peter was the big man after Pentecost? He was on fire. I mean, he was everything. But as you move through the book of Acts, you notice that Peter sort of goes away. As Paul becomes more and more important, Paul kind of moves away. His single thing was just different from what it had been before, and it changes. And this is true for most of us. Example I can think of is the story of Philip. It's also in the book of Acts. Philip was hanging out in Jerusalem, sharing the good news when an angel of the Lord suddenly spoke to him and said, "Arise and go south to the road, the desert road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." So Paul did what, as he was told. He ran into an Ethiopian sitting in a chair trying to make some sense out of Isaiah the prophet. To make a long story short, Philip explained the text to the eunuch, and the eunuch ended up accepting Jesus and getting baptized. So from beginning to end, Philip's Gaza ministry probably lasted about 2.5 hours. And what happened then? It comes now. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and the eunuch went on his way rejoicing. But Philip was found in Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea. And this is the ministry. This is the ministry. When we give our lives to the Lord, when we are truly surrendered everything we have, at some point we're going to be caught away by the Spirit, and then we will be found in some place like Malta that we never dreamed we would end up. And a new ministry begins. A new ministry begins. You see, being Spirit-led means willing to change course, even to change ministries at any given time. In any given time, it means not putting God in a box. It means not holding on to what isn't working. It means letting go and letting God direct all of the traffic. And let's note, Luke tells us in verse 10, when we were ready to sail, the natives furnished us with all the supplies we needed. This confirms one of my very favorite promises of the Lord. And it goes like this: where God guides, God provides. Where God guides, God provides. Which means, if you're feeling called by God to do something for Him, don't worry about the things you may need. Where God guides, God provides. Where God guides, God provides. In closing, here again are the keys to effective ministry. Key one, bloom where planted. You've already been shipwrecked on Malta, start gathering some brushwood. Two, pitch in. Don't wait to be waited on. Your first step may be to fix that first step. Key three, shake it off. Don't let them see you sweat or hear you swear. Remember, everybody is watching you. Key four, be humble, or better yet, be nothing. That way, you never have anything to lose. Key five, be available. Ministry is about the people. Always put people first. Key six, use your gift. Don't bury your talent. If you will use your gift for God, He will empower it to do greater things than you've ever imagined. Key seven, be Spirit-led. Seek the Lord constantly and don't be afraid to change what isn't working. And remember, very few ministries last forever. A born-again believer is like the wind, which is why Jesus told Nicodemus in John 3:8, the wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So is everyone born of the Spirit. And that's you. That's you. Everyone in this room has been born of the Spirit, which means the wind's blowing us somewhere. We don't always know. Stay available and just stay with it as long as you can. Father, we thank you that you've taken so much time to help us do the things that you asked us to do. Lord, we look to you for strength. We look to you for information. We look to you for joy, for love. We look to you for everything. And Lord, we thank you that you're so faithful to supply the things we need. And we ask that you just bless this group in Jesus' name. And I have one last song for you, then you can get to go. This one's in your bulletin. One of the hardest songs I've ever done. Steve, you want to come and sing with me? John?
Jesus, I surrender. Sign up sheets in there where the coffee is. Thank you for being here this morning.